السلام عليكم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. There's a concept in the Abrahamic locution that we refer to as nesting. Nesting. This is part of the methodology, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us many ways, many hints that we should use the concept of nesting while unraveling. So you take out, it's like somebody described it as like onion skins. You take out the first layer and you discover something else, you take it out and so on until you get to the qurra. Qurra is the essence, the heart, the thing that gets stuck to your core that doesn't leave you after you understand it. Once you grab it, it stays with you. You cannot just let go of it because it's so beautiful and so touching and so real and so connected to the ultimate source of the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will see for yourself. The Quran uses a single word or a single expression, and it expects you, because you have been going through the Quran and trying to pay attention to everything the Quran says, to understand what this one word or one expression implies. So it is an indirect linguistic reference. It's not a direct linguistic reference. It's not just to a single meaning of that word. It is to the whole subroutine, the whole representative symbolic story that is included in the Quran in relationship to that term. So the word kawkab in the story of Yusuf, verse 4 or ayah 4, is exactly that. It's insider talk. So a kawkab for us in this surah includes all of that subroutine. You have to understand what the story about kawkab is. Where? In the Abrahamic locution. So where do we learn about the Abrahamic locution in relationship to kawkab? By referencing kawkab, you need to get into your awareness that now we're introducing a brand new concept, the concept of kawkab in the Quran as defined in the Abrahamic locution. Now, was Yusuf and his father part of the Abrahamic tradition? You betcha. They're talking that type of insider talk. The language of the poets, as you will realize, has nothing to do with it. And what I mean by the language of the poets, the language of the Arab poets. The language of the Arab poets is the basis for all the translations and the interpretations that people have produced regarding the Quran. You will see. All right, so let's look at the story of Al-Kawkab. Now we have to jump. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ This is verse 74 from Surah Al-An'am, which is Surah 6. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ آزَرْ أَتَتَّخِذُ أَصْنَامًا آلِهَةً إِنِّي أَرَاكَ وَقَوْمَكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِيَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ فَلَمَّا جَنَّ عَلَيْهِ اللَّيْلُ رأى كوكبا قال هذا ربي فلما أفل قال لا أحب الآفلين فلما رأى القمر بازغا قال هذا ربي فلما أفل قال لئن لم يهدني ربي لأكونن من القوم الضالين فلما رأى الشمس بازغة قال هذا ربي هذا أكبر فلما أفلت قال يا قوم إني بريء مما تشركون. And thus Ibrahim said to his father Azar, do you take idols for gods? Verily, I see you and your people in manifest aberration. Now, I underlined this word between parentheses. Remember this. We're going to see it a little later. Okay? It's a very important concept in the process of interpreting the Quran. And thus, we gave Ibrahim insight into the mighty dominion, the malakut, the mighty dominion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the heavens and the earth, so that he becomes of those with certainty. For when the night plunged him in its total darkness, he saw, now remember, up here, he was talking to his father. And he's telling his father, you take idols for gods. In other words, you follow the crowd. And we know from other stories that his father told him, we just follow what we found our forefathers teaching us. They were doing this and we just follow them. We just do like them, right? So part of that story includes the concept that Azar, his father, was just following like a planet goes in its orbit. It follows. As a matter of fact, the word kawkab, as is described in the dictionaries, any dictionary you pick it up, and this is just pure linguistic analysis, from the word wakaba, wakaba, which is wakaba also, that gerund means to accompany or to stick with or to stay with or to follow. So al-kawkab, as the word in the Abrahamic locution is used, it's something that follows in somebody else's orbit. So what we call a follower or a blind follower, because the kawkab, the planet, cannot really have a choice of getting out of its orbit unless some other influence comes and causes that getting out. So in other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing or has instructed Ibrahim to use that word kawkab in that sense. So when the story is told to us in Surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing the word kawkab, but he's really referring to his father. So when he saw his father following blindly, he didn't like this. The guidance he was receiving from his father waned, sort of weakened after a while. So falamma afala, that guidance, that sense of comfort did not stay with him, and he did not like that. He says, I don't like that feeling because he, the father, his belief or his faith, you know, ebbs and flows, increases and wanes and reduces, and so is mine, and I don't like this. I need to be attached to the true God and have a faith or a belief that doesn't change. So he says this kawkab cannot be the source of guidance. And then you know the rest of the story. Then he saw the moon, and it's the same thing. And then he saw the sun, and it's the same thing. Now, he saw literally, physically, because, you know, in the middle of the night, he saw the planet, one planet. And that's a question mark, by the way. That tells us the whole story is representative. Because literally, when you're in the middle of the whole night, it's dark. How many planets do you see? Millions of planets. And yet the story tells us one. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sort of pointing out that, look, this kawkab that I'm talking about in here is not what you think. Al-kawkab that he just talked about, which is his father who follows blindly, right? So it's not just the real planet. It's one out of millions, meaning he's talking about somebody specific. And that's a signal. That's a hint that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in all of the stories. And you have to be really observant. Okay, so when the night went really dark, he saw only one? Well, he's talking about one, which is his father in this case. And then later on, he saw the moon. It's the same thing. And then later on, he saw the sun. And it's the same thing. And he just said, whatever I'm looking for cannot be seen with the eye. And that's the whole story from Surah Al-An'am. All right. So Ibrahim went through this story with his followers, including his children, including his descendants. And I'm sure Yaqub and Yusuf studied this story and understood this story. Not only understood this story, understood the metaphorical language used to explain this story. And thus, now we have that subroutine clear in our head. So when Yusuf is talking about planets, plural, he's talking about this type of planets. The planets who are blind followers, all right? As you see, now we understand the beginning of Surah Yusuf, at least that one verse, that one ayah, to mean something totally different. Ayah 4 starts the story of Yusuf proper. If you have come into the Quran, assuming that this is the story of Joseph that I can look up in the corrupted version of the earlier scriptures, you already have in your mind that ayah number 4 is talking about a dream. And not only that, but these planets that are prostrating and so on and so forth all match exactly what went on with the corrupted version of the Torah. So we're safe to go there, all right? Doing that one first misstep misleads you for the rest of the story. It's like going down the stairs, tripping on the very first step. You don't know where you end up at the bottom. This first step will take you down the wrong path. You're sort of down the wrong rabbit hole. And once you're there, after that first slip up, it is very hard to pull yourself back up. Right from the beginning of that story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put enough hints that this is just like that one. Hints, they're not real, as we saw. If you're awake, if you're alert, if you're attentive, has nothing to do with that. Right from the beginning, he says ra'a. Ra'a does not mean a dream. But yet, if you insist that this is the same story, in that story, it's a dream. Because it's the most famous part of the story of Joseph. For those who learn the story of Yusuf from the corrupted version of the Torah. If you fall down that first big step, you're down the rabbit hole, and from there on, you cannot pull back yourself. Is this concept my own invention? Let's read. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks exactly about doing this to those who approach the Quran with the wrong assumption. With the wrong assumption, I mean what I said. So if you're starting the Quran with that wrong assumption, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a plan for you. It's a trap. Be careful. Be awake. Here's what this ayah is talking about. This is Surah Al-A'raf, number 7, ayah 146. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَأَصْرِفُ عَنْ آيَاتِي الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَإِنْ يَرَوْ كُلَّ آيَةٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَا وَإِنْ يَرَوْ سَبِيلَ الرُّشْدِ لا يتخذوه سبيلا وإن يروا سبيل الغي يتخذوه سبيلا ذلك بأنهم كذبوا بآياتنا وكانوا عنها غافلين. I shall distract away from my signs, from my ayat, those who take to interpret the scriptures. By the way, the word ard is part of the Abrahamic locution. Most of the time in the Quran, ard means the scripture. I shall distract away from my signs, from my ayat, those who take to interpret the scripture with arrogance. Arrogance in this case means I know better. I have a previous opinion that I'm going to start with. I know some of this stuff. I don't need to start from scratch. This is arrogance. Because you're approaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your cup half full or full. Doesn't work. When you approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to learn from His signs in the scripture, you have to approach like a poor, deprived person begging for guidance. Your cup has to be totally empty. Your eyes have to be totally virgin. You don't know anything. You're learning things for the first time. That total submissiveness is what leads you to perhaps deserve the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He will guide you. This is the relationship we have with the Quran. Quran is not something we put on the shelf. Quran is not something we recite in funerals and weddings and to be entertained with Abdul Basit and so on. The Quran is word by word striving to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His guidance. And the rewards are absolutely amazing. The story of Yusuf that we will cover inshallah over the time is stunning, is beautiful, is so full of information and wisdom and philosophy and guidance on leadership and guidance on state security and guidance to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam how to run a state, who to watch out for, how to worry about certain cliques, how to worry about certain people who may stab you in the back. How do you look for evidence? Full, tons of information. I have over 80 pages written just on the translation of Surah Yusuf. And inshallah, in due time, we will release it. I shall distract away from my signs those who take to interpret the scripture with arrogance, ignoring the truth, بغير الحق, holding on to something other than what Allah calls al-haq. Al-haq in the eyes of Allah for us is the Quran. Nothing else. Nothing else. Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, my honorable leader, I would be honored to be his doormat. But when it came to the Quran, he was learning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were telling him. And the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were telling him, be patient, don't rush, and ask Allah for guidance. And so, thus, we learn the same way. We ask Allah for guidance. When they ignored the truth, they started and approached the Quran, assuming they already knew the bulk of the story. They started on the wrong foot. That first step, ayah number 4, they slipped and went down the wrong rabbit hole. Watch what happens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in ayah 146. If they see every sign, they will not believe in those signs. So when they read the rest of the Surah Yusuf, they already had formed an opinion. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped allowing them to see His signs. You want to have it your way? Go ahead and do your own interpretation based on the fabricated story that you started with. And that's what they did. Every single one of them. And they admitted it. All of them admitted that this story has been reported in, quote unquote, the Torah that was available to them. Every single time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the people of the Torah, He told us they corrupted it. And yet, the interpreters insisted. This is where we're going to get the story. And therefore, they retrofitted the Torah version of the story on top of the Quran. The Quran was no longer their primary source. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevented them from seeing His sign. This is what these verses are telling us, these ayat. And if they see the way of finding the correct direction, سبيل الرشد, they will not adopt it. And if they see the way of finding the wrong direction, Allah told you those earlier scriptures have been corrupted. No, I'm going to go get the story from there. I challenge anyone to find a single interpretation, tafsir, that does not use the exact story from the Torah. So don't tell me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not warn us. He warned us. But there are some people who approach the Quran with no submissiveness. They refuse to come with an empty cup. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, I'll leave you to yourself. And as a result, not only you mislead yourself, you mislead the millions who have followed them in the last 1400 years. The rest of this ayah, if they see the way of finding the correct direction, which is spelled out clearly in the Quran, they will not follow it. They will not adopt it. If they see the way of finding the wrong direction, they will embrace it. They will adopt it. That is so because, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing this? Because they belied our sign. They belied our signs. كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. How did they belie the signs? In Surah Yusuf itself, as I told you in the video segment, which the title is, How Much Confidence Do You Have in the Quran? I recited to you the very first ayah is ayah 12:102. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us at the very end of this story, of this surah, ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الْغَيْبِ. This is reports that nobody knows. And yet they said, no, we know this stuff. It's coming from the Torah. So we're going to go there and sort of peek and look at the Torah and bring it and kind of shortcut the whole concept, the whole process. That is so because they belied our signs, our ayat, and they were inattentive to them. They were dismissive. So when they read verse 102, ayah 102, nah, it must mean something else. And they skipped over it. حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل. So why did they represent or misrepresent Surah Yusuf? They started with the wrong foot, with the very first ayah in the story proper, ayah 4. The pious ones decided it was a dream about his 11 brothers and his father and his mother. And I have no clue how planets would prostrate in a dream. You tell me, if any of you, please write me in the comment. How do planets prostrate in a dream? You tell me. I couldn't figure it out. When I came to translating it, I thought, okay, well, planets are prostrating. What does that mean? I can't even visualize it. I can't even put an image to it. Not even in a cartoonish way. What does that mean? Planets are prostrating. And yet they accepted it. Hook, line, and sinker. Misleading millions, if not billions, of Muslims. May Allah forgive them and forgive us. Maybe they tried, maybe they didn't think, maybe they were not paying attention. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They did not ascribe to Allah His due reverence. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a light matter. It's not something you undertake lightly when you're dealing with His signs and His words and His scripture. This is divine information. You take it with full seriousness or don't take it at all. If you don't understand, if you don't want to say anything, you don't know what to say anything, stop and say nothing. There is one scholar, by the way. He's a modern scholar. May Allah be pleased with him and forgive him. He refused to follow in the path of those mufassirun. He says something doesn't smell right. And I'm not going to take from the Torah story. And when he came to Surah Yusuf, all he could do is talk about 13 verses, 13 ayah. That's it. Out of 111 ayah in Surah Yusuf, he talked about 13 ayah and he stopped. This is piety. This is discipline. This is taqwa. He understood he's dealing with something very serious. He refrained from saying anything other than these 13 ayah that he could understand. He says, the rest, I don't understand. So he stopped. He didn't talk. And you find in his tafsir that he talks about these 13 ayahs and then he has sort of fluffy notes on the rest, but no real explanation. And he just left it at that. And you look at it, and it's a clear gap in his tafsir. But perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prevented him from falling down that first step, that first ayah, ayah 4. He didn't take the wrong road and therefore prevented him from falling down the wrong rabbit hole. Now, you think this is serious? Let me show you even more. This is the closing, inshallah. In a couple of minutes, we will wrap up. This is the real tragedy for us. As a brother of mine told me, we are in deep, deep trouble. And it's even more than you think. It doesn't please me to tell you this. And please don't take it against me. I'm only sharing with you what's in front of your eyes. I'm asking you to pay attention. Wake up. Listen. Learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us. And then you judge. Look at this ayah from Surah Al-Furqan. وقال الذين كفروا إن هذا إلا إفك افتراه وأعانه عليه قوم آخرون فقد جاءوا ظلما وزورا. وقالوا أساطير الأولين اكتتبها فهي تملى عليه بكرة وأصيلة. This is addressing the disbelievers and how they dealt with our beloved Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. They said, the disbelievers, this Quran is nothing but lies that he concocted, he invented them, and with which others helped him. أعانه عليه قوم آخرون. Others have helped him put this together. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes that first ayah with his conclusion, telling us how to think about this. They have brought forth transgression and false testimony. Zur, testimony that is false, lying. And then the next ayah. And they also said, these are the writings of people of old, which he had someone write down for him. And they are dictated to him or upon him mornings and evenings. Now, I know my Arab brothers are going to jump all over me because this word, the writings or asatir, means, in their opinion, according to their dictionaries and their translations and their interpretations, they all interpreted as fables, myths. But the word from the Quran, if you look up the word from the Quran, such as in Surah Noon, Al-Qalam, Noon wal qalam wama yasturun. This is ayah number 1. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he's swearing, Noon, by the pen and what they write. Yasturun, the same gerund, satara. So asatir is from yasturun satara, which means the writings. So these disbelievers, Allah is telling us, these disbelievers accused Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam that he is bringing the writings of other people and someone is reciting them to him day and night. Who? The opponents of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam in his life. And the Quran is recording this for us so that it is not up to those who transmitted these narrations whether or not they will tell us. Allah himself told us. This is what happened to your prophet during his life, all right? So what did our esteemed, pious predecessors do? They confirmed this. They did exactly what the Quran said Muhammad's opponents were doing. They said, oh yeah. We're going to get these same stories from those other books. If you're feeling pain in your stomach right now, you have the right to. If you're not feeling it, there's something that you missed. You didn't understand what I talked about. You should feeling that pit in your stomach, that sort of peach sitting here, that pain, that agony, that sorrow, that sadness that should engulf you. For the millions of people who have been misled by this wrong approach our so-called pious predecessors took. Don't ask me why. I have no idea. I'm just sharing with you the facts. I explained to you why they did it. How they did it, how they took that wrong first step and tripped down the rest of the steps. And every single commentator and explainer of the Quran doing tafsir followed exactly in the same path. And we take pride in making movies and series, one of the most popular right now in the whole Arab world. The most popular Arabic series ever produced was the story of Yusuf according to this wrong interpretation. Quran, no, put it aside. We know better. Subhanallah. I ask you to take a while to reflect. Embrace this pain, embrace this sorrow. When I first discovered this, I was sick for 3 full weeks, literally sick, throwing up, unable to move, unable to live, because I taught their story for 30 years. Alhamdulillah, I didn't have that broad of a reach during those years. But I made a commitment when I recovered from my sickness, I will not die before correcting my mistake. And that's why I'm sharing this with you. I ask you to reflect, think, allow this to sink in, feel the sadness, feel the sense of loss. Yes, embrace it. Detoxification is always painful. But most of all, don't take it against the messenger. I'm not the one who caused this problem. Don't misplace your anger against me. But now, we have a chance to fix it. This is the good news. We have an opportunity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in front of us. You know, many people ask me, why now? Dr. Hany, why now? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealing such dramatic change compared to the last 1400 years? I say, I don't know, but perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a chance to fix it. We have a lot of work to do. I just barely scratched the surface with one verse, one ayah. Ayah number 4. The rest of the story is so magnificent. The Quranic story is just so beautiful that they deprived us of these nuggets and jewels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deposited in the Quran. Finally, we don't forget this dua. Alhamdulillah, alladhi hadana li hadha wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Laqad ja'at rusul rabbina bil haqq. Praise be to Allah who guided us to this, and we were never to be guided were it not for His direct guidance. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the direct guidance. You have to ask for it and be sincere. I invite you to continue with me on this journey, and I ask you all to support this channel by subscribing, liking, sharing, and please include comments, any comment you want, in a polite manner. Ask the question in an open-ended way, expecting to receive some new information. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to your modesty, will give you the information you're requesting. Thank you very much for watching. Salamun alaikum.